أغلى المي المودة والصداقة.
Good afternoon. You're watching the English newscast on Future Television. I'm Yumna Naufal, and these are today's top stories. Casualties recorded as the winter storm Perla pummels Lebanon, causing a tree to land on a warehouse where a Syrian displaced family is living in Akkad. Syrian government forces take back control of an area near Damascus that provides most of the capital's water supplies after reaching a deal with rebel fighters. And President Donald Trump stresses the United States' special relationship with Britain during a joint news conference at the White House with Prime Minister Theresa May. A baby girl was killed when a huge tree uprooted by a winter storm pummeling Lebanon landed on a warehouse where a Syrian displaced family was living in the northern district of Akkad. This is according to the National News Agency. It's reporting that as a result of the winter storm Perla hitting Lebanon, the large tree fell on a warehouse in the Kfar Milki town in Akkad, where a Syrian family displaced by the war ravaging in Syria is residing. The baby, known as Salam Arif al-Fawri, 5 months old, was killed instantly, and the family was forced to leave the refuge after its destruction. Lebanon's stormy weather is causing several mountain towns to be blocked. Villages in Batroun, as low as 600 meters high above sea level, witnessed a rare precipitation of snow in the coastal area. The East Lebanon town of Baalbek was hit by heavy snow, which accumulated to over 10 centimeters high and blocked roads in the area. Syrian government forces are taking back control of an area near Damascus that provides most of the capital's water supplies after reaching a deal for rebel fighters to withdraw. Pro-government media and activists are saying the Syrian army and its allies launched an offensive last month to drive insurgents from the Wadi Barada Valley, which they have controlled since 2012, and recaptured a major spring and pumping station. Syria's mainstream rebel factions are under intense pressure after losing areas they held in the northern city of Aleppo to government forces at the end of last year. They are now facing a fierce assault by militants elsewhere. Wadi Barada, which lies northwest of Damascus, has become one of the fiercest battlefronts in Syria's civil war. Disruption to water supplies, including infrastructure damage, has caused acute shortages in the capital. An Iraqi officer says Iraqi forces discovered sulfur mustard, a chemical warfare agent, in Mosul alongside a cache of Russian surface-to-surface missiles. Iraqi Special Forces General Haider Badhil said French officials tested the chemical agent this week and confirmed it was sulfur mustard. Iraqi forces showed journalists a tank of the chemical agent and a warehouse of more than a dozen rockets bearing Russian inscriptions in eastern Mosul. Fadil said the types of rockets found led them to suspect ISIS was experimenting with the rockets to develop a way to weaponize the chemical agent. Iraqi and U.S. officials have repeatedly warned of ISIS efforts to develop these kinds of weapons. The group has launched attacks using low-grade weapons in Iraq, causing a handful of casualties. President Donald Trump stresses the United States' special relationship with Britain during a joint news conference at the White House with Prime Minister Theresa May. Trump also made reference to the political shifts that brought him and May into office. May congratulated him on his stunning election victory and thanked him for inviting her.
Well, I hear a call was set up, Steve, and we'll see what happens. As far as the sanctions, very early to be talking about that. But we look to have a great relationship with all countries, ideally. That won't necessarily happen. Unfortunately, probably won't happen with many countries. But if we can have, as we do with Prime Minister May and the relationship that we've all developed, and even in the short relationship that we've just developed, just by being with each other, we're going to have lunch, and we've really had some very interesting talks and very productive talks. But if we can have a great relationship with Russia and with China and with all countries, I'm all for that. That would be a tremendous asset.
Mr. President, and can I start by saying that I'm so pleased that I've been able to be here today, and thank you for inviting me so soon after your inauguration. And I'm delighted to be able to congratulate you on what was a stunning election victory. And as you say, the invitation is an indication of the strength and importance of the special relationship that exists between our two countries, a relationship based on the bonds of history, of family, kinship, and common interests. And in a further sign of the importance of that relationship, our two nations are already leading efforts to face up to this challenge, and we're making progress with Daesh losing territory and fighters, but we need to redouble our efforts. And today we're discussing how we can do this by deepening intelligence and security cooperation, and critically by stepping up our efforts to counter Daesh in cyberspace, because we know we will not eradicate this threat until we defeat the idea, the ideology that lies behind it.
Coming up next, La La Land becomes the movie to beat at the 89th Academy Awards. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Making headlines all the week since his inauguration, U.S. President Donald Trump told the Brody File on CBN News that he had a constructive telephone conversation with the president of Mexico after tensions between Mexico and the U.S. earlier this week over the construction of a border wall. Trump also said that he reserved the right to tax Mexican imports to help pay for building the wall. He said it's something that he has the right to do and it's something he can impose if he wants.
They've been horribly treated. Do you know, if you were a Christian in Syria, it was impossible, very, very tough to get into the United States. If you were a Muslim, you could come in. But if you were a Christian, it was almost impossible. And the reason that was so unfair is that everybody was persecuted, in all fairness, but they were chopping off the heads of everybody, but more so the Christians. And I thought it was very, very unfair. So we are going to help them.
Steve Bannon, one of your top advisors, just the other day to the New York Times, called the media the opposition party. Do you believe that?
I think to a large extent they're much more capable than the other side. I think the media is the opposition party in many ways. And I think that, and I'm not talking about all media. I know people like yourself, but I know people in the media that I have tremendous respect for, respect them as much as anybody. Mm-hmm. So I'm not talking about everybody, but a big portion of the media, the dishonesty, the total deceit and deception makes them certainly partially the opposition party, absolutely. I think they're much more capable than the opposition party. The opposition party is losing badly. Now, the media is on the opposition party's side. And I actually said to myself, I say, they treat me so unfairly, it's hard to believe that I won. But the fortunate thing about me is I have a big voice. I have a voice that people understand. And you see it now. We're bringing back jobs. Ford is making a massive investment now in Michigan. General Motors is going to be making, you know, just magnificent investments. So many other companies are coming back in. But yeah, the media is a disgrace. And they've called me wrong from the beginning. I mean, New York Times has called me wrong from the beginning.
Underestimated you.
They actually apologized to their readers. They lost a lot of subscriptions mm-hmm. because they're not because the readers even like me. Mm-hmm. They said, how inaccurate could you be? Mm-hmm. Because if you read the New York Times, there was no chance that Trump was going to win. And yet we'd go out there and I'd feel I was going to win based on the crowds. You saw the crowds better than anybody. Mm-hmm. So it's a very interesting fact.
A day after La La Land became the movie to beat at the Academy Awards, bookmakers are naming it as a favorite to win Best Picture. The film has earned 14 with nods that included Best Picture, Actor, Actress, Director, Score, and Screenplay. The musical is about a struggling actress played by Emma Stone and her jazz pianist boyfriend played by Ryan Gosling. And they equaled the record set by the 1997 blockbuster Titanic 20 years ago and the 1950 film All About AIDS. Here are the actors, director speaking.
City of stars, are you shining just for me? City of stars, there's so much that I can't see.
Good editing, good score.
Is really
just
key.
Creates. And then there's, you know.
Right.
And then there's a little.
Oh, and plus.
Bing. Yeah, and then that's.
And then you got it.
I thought in this town it worked on a sort of one for you, one for me type system. How about two for you, one for me? How about All for you and none for me.
That's perfect, yes.
Great.
Okay.
Okay, mutual decision then.
Right, made by me.
Right, and I sign off on it, so.
This is a project we're really proud of, proud to be a part of, and seeing all this buzz around the awards, you know, you never know what you're going to get when you're making these projects. All you can focus on is quality, focus on making it the best art it can be, and then hopefully the commercial success and the awards will take care of itself.
I got a call back.
What? Come on! For what?
For a TV show. The one that I was telling you about earlier.
The Dangerous Minds meets the OC?
Yeah.
Congratulations! That's
really
incredible.
Exciting.
Well, the harnesses and the floating, that's...
I was going to say, floating is very painful. I loved floating, though. I just really loved it.
I love the floating.
No, not as much. Not quite as much. Although originally the idea of that was that we would maybe be underwater, which I'm grateful didn't happen.
Yeah. That would be fun.
The thing I'm the most thrilled about is actually the extent to which it is still the vision that I had in my head, you know, 6 years ago. I think that was my fear, was that this was such a hard movie to describe to people, you know, and to try to convince people to give money for, that it seemed for a long time like it wasn't realistic that, you know, we'd actually be able to make what was in our heads.
It's like Rebel Without a Cause, sort of.
I got the bullets!
Yes.
You've never seen it?
I've never seen it.
Oh my. You know it's playing at the Rialto.
Really?
Yes. You should go. I mean, I can take you.
Okay.
You know, for research.
For research?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
The whole preparation period for 3 months of practicing for all of these things was like every day just a lot of failing. And it wasn't until, because you're always reaching for the next thing that, you know, once you get comfortable with one thing, then you're trying to learn how to do something else. And it wasn't until we were shooting, I think, that we had time to look back and see how far we had all come. And it was a nice just experience to see what you're capable of, you know? I think a lot of people are saying that it's, you know, but I think if you took 3 months, 3 or 6 hours a day like we had to learn some of these things, I think you'd be surprised at how much you could do too, you know?
I've been dreaming about being in this position in my career since I was, you know, 6, 7 years old, watching the Grammys or, you know, watching Soul Train and seeing my favorite artists on the show and saying, man, I wish I was there.
I loved that. I mean, I love the kind of, I feel like I learned a lot on this and asking questions about, you know, the way it was going to be shot and seeing that was, I don't know, I love all the color and the life in it. The vibrancy.
There was a lot of added color, but there was...
The blues, the reds.
The green, the purples.
The yellows.
Yeah.
The yellows.
The puces.
Keep saying colors
no
as
one
you
talks
try to
about
answer the question.
Puces.
No one mentions puce.
They don't.
Or chartreuse.
I'm not familiar with breaking into song, obviously. There's a certain kind of, I wanted it to have an emotional truth to it, and certainly a lot of the, you know, it's about two people who are in LA trying to make art, and that was me. I moved to LA wanting to make movies, drawn to, you know, this dream factory of a city that I think it still is in many ways, and for a long time it seemed like those dreams would never come true.
This marks the end of our bulletin for today. Now for a reminder of our headlines. Casualties recorded as the winter storm Perla pummels Lebanon, causing a tree to land on a warehouse where a Syrian family was living in the district of Aqqad. Syrian government forces take back control of an area near Damascus that provides most of the capital's water after reaching a deal with rebel fighters to withdraw. And President Donald Trump stresses the United States' special relationship with Britain during a joint news conference at the White House with Prime Minister Theresa May. Those are your Saturday headlines live on Future Television. I'm Yumna Naufa signing off. Have a good weekend.
Hello. and Maria de los Ángeles.